Hello everyone, thanks for joining us today, the Real Links YouTube channel. Today I'm actually going to walk you through how to install EVGA's SR-2 HPTX form factor motherboard in the giant Lian-Li PC-P80 armor suit Lian-Li case. I've been seeing a lot of questions and concerns online through EVGA.com's forums and overclock.net and other, you know, hardware sites about how much, just wondering how much modding and changing is required to this case to make it fit this particular enthusiast motherboard. So I figure today I'll just take some time and walk you through the process. What you can see there might be hard to tell from the image and video is my Droid X sitting next to the tower case box. As you can see, it's an absolutely gargantuan case, with the Droid X being one of the biggest phones on the market today. You can get an idea of just how much desk or floor space you might need. So without further ado, let's go through the process. And now that we have the PC-P80 out of the box, you can again compare just to how big of a case this is compared to the Droid X. I'm not going to bother going into features, as there are other many excellent reviews on this case, such as from 3D Game Man, Anantech, and other sites, but those of you who are already in the market for an SR-2 probably know the benefits and drawbacks of this case. The first step is of course the easiest. Simply place the case down, and the back side for each panel has three thumb screws that you can simply twist and take off. For added benefit, Lian-Li actually made the thumb screws have flathead notches, so if they are on too tight, like mine were, simply take a flathead screwdriver and you can screw them off. In fact, the only thing I have to say, sorry about how it's leaning, the case is so big, it won't even fit on this table. Now that the thumb screws have been removed, simply pull the side panel out and take it straight off. Inside you will find all the fan headers for the three front, one top, and one rear fan, as well as a cardboard accessory box which has everything from standoffs to regular drive screws to rubber grommets and all the accessories that come with the case so that you can securely connect anything that you might want to put inside. Now, in order to access the motherboard tray, we repeat the process for the other side. Before removing the motherboard tray, I'd like to briefly highlight the accessory package that comes with the case. Now before I remove the motherboard tray, I'd like to go over the accessories that you get with this case. The first up is a little tackle box for holding your screws. Next up we have little grooved threaded screws that are the main drive support screws. Next up there is a little multi-pack plastic cable ties, these long plastic cable ties, these little long graphic card, PCIe or PEG graphic card screws, as well as lots of rubber grommets and other things. Next up is for that large crossbar on the one side of the case. They give you graphic card plastic extenders. Just snap it in, and it helps support the weight of heavy graphics cards. Now, due to the fact I'm putting two 580s in this system, I don't know if that crossbar will need to be removed, but may not use these. Next up, we have regular drive securing screws. Here we have regular standoff screws. Standoffs for the motherboard. Two keys for the front case lock. Now these, as gimmicky as it may seem, are actually pretty useful, because this case without hardware in it is incredibly front-weighted. The front cover there is a solid door and pretty heavy, and so you can very easily tell as it's sitting or being carried that it's front-weighted, and these will help you secure and lock the door when you're moving it or in travel, and not have it swing around. So this is actually kind of helpful. Last up, we have an Intel NUMA. The manual wasn't even precise. NUMA. Plate. I don't know if it fills this in on the back plate or what it does, but it's in there. To remove the motherboard tray, you can see there are three Phillips screws coupled with a couple more thumb screws on the back side of the case. Now, I don't know what particular size the screws are, but I did have no problem matching them with a small to medium size screwdriver. To remove the motherboard tray itself, it's as easy as pulling it toward the front of the case, along the small slotted groove that it sits in, tilt it out, and remove it. And here we have the totally awesome EVGA SR-2 motherboard. Now, normally I'd be jumping for joy and totally ecstatic to own such a great piece of hardware, except for the fact that, well, people are asleep right now, and waking them up would be bad. So, you guys have to deal with the subdued tone for now. But anyway, so obviously if you're looking at in the market for this type of board, you don't need me to reiterate the specs, just how capable it is, and unfortunately the fact that it does cost quite a bit for a board. Now, there are many great sites online, such as Trooper Tower's YouTube channel, and among other review sites, that go into more detail if you need to know the specs and just what the capabilities of this board are. So anyway, moving along to putting this into a PC-P80, there are a total of 12 standoffs, motherboard standoffs, small hex screws that they line up with the board and separate it not only from the chassis and the computer case, but also make it line up and functional with how the standards are made. So a total of 10 of the 12 holes for this board happen to line up with the tray, which is great. There are the five on the left side there. One is by the I/O ports, the input, output, the peripheral ports. You might be able to see it there. The other three or four are by the PEG or PCIe Express red, add-in cards or graphic card, sound card, network card, so on. Express ports lanes there. There are two more at the very bottom of the board. One is under the heatsink, actually. Thank you to Hellscream on the overclock.net forums for pointing that out to me, by the way. Props there, because obviously it wouldn't have seen that. The last three are on the far right side of the board, by the SATA data headers where you connect your hard drives. The top two are the last two. Now those don't line up. They are by CPU 0 on the right side, the right socket there. And there's on top of that is the VRM, I believe, the voltage regulator manifest or the manifold, basically the big silver heatsink that helps work with the processor on that side. There are two small holes there that do not line up. And now there are two solutions for this. One is that in EVGA's accessory box for the board, you will have these tiny cone-shaped rubber or plastic standoffs, and you can just punch it through the board and remove the adhesive and stick it and secure the board. The other is to actually do a machine job and drill and tap the holes to connect to the motherboard tray. Sorry about that, had to switch out memory cards. Anyway, about connecting the last two points to the motherboard tray, the two ways, basically you can drill and tap those holes, or you can use EVGA's little plastic standoff. And now, these plastic standoff adhesive pads, they look like they work great. I'm sure they do. The concern I have, though, is that there'll be pretty weighty heat sinks on this board, coupled with two fairly heavy GTX 580s. And it's been recommended that I have the board as secure as possible in the case, and so I feel like not using these. And the other set is, I happen to know a machinist I can go to and have this done. You can certainly do it yourself, though I don't feel comfortable with it. The holes, I believe, take an M, according to EVGA's forums, the standoffs are an M3 size, and the holes themselves are a 6/32 inch diameter. So you can always grab a drill, drill slightly smaller than that, and then tap and bring them to size. I've heard it's easy, but again, I don't feel comfortable doing it, and I know someone that has a much more equipment than I do that wouldn't mind doing this. So figured to do it safe, do it right, and have it completely secure would be the best way to go. Now, I will go into a closer view on the camera there to show you the standoffs that don't line up, as well as removing the NF200 bridge heatsink in a moment. And here we are looking at the CPU 0 socket and the heatsink above it. Hopefully you can see the two tiny star or asterisk shaped holes next to the little curved ends there. Those are the two mounting points that do not meet up. For further information and a graphical illustration of the board compared to the mounting on the tray, I've also included an image that you can reference for quick review. And here we have the heatsink for the NF200 NVIDIA bridge chips that bring X16 Express graphics capability to four of the seven lanes, right next to it, the red PCI Express lanes. Like I said, there is a mounting hole under the cooler there. Really, the top is just a facade. I've removed it once. But again, I do not know in particular what size screws those are. I tried some of the multi-screw little sets, like for glasses and different, you know, smaller screws. I actually had a flathead, sure enough, work to remove the screws there, but I do not know what size they are. They're just very small. On that note, keep in mind, they are very small and very, very easily losable, so do keep that in mind. I will be removing the heatsink in just a second. Once all four screws have been removed, the top plate simply lifts off. You can see the remaining mounting hole under the top plate for the heatsink. This concludes part one for the tutorial. Thank you very much for watching. Hope it's been informative and answered some questions. Part two will be after tomorrow when I can get the necessary machining done, and I'll go ahead and take the board, mount it to the board tray, and install it in the case, and we will have, hopefully soon, a working system. Thanks for watching.